Today's agenda includes a request for determination of applicability to determine if deck replacement is subject to the Wetlands Act or the Northampton City Wetlands Ordinance. This is Smith College at the Conference Center in College Lane. Then a request for determination of applicability to determine the relocation of an underground drainage pipe is subject to the Wetlands Act or the Wetlands Ordinance. This being submitted by the City of Northampton. And at 6 o'clock, a notice of intent for building addition and related work within the riverfront area. This is Ralph's back blacksmith on Smith Street. We also have some review of some suggested amendments to the ordinance, which I'm guessing we will, if we approve, we have, is there a step in between us and the council, sir?
I would go to City Council. Council would refer it out to ordinance.
So,
and
go back to the ordinance group from council. Okay.
Yes.
And then determination of some housekeeping items. First, we had two sets of minutes that Sarah sent out. One for executive session and one for regular session. It looked okay to me, but I don't have the dates.
Executive session was September.
So with this 24th was the executive session?
That was the
executive session. All right, we'll take that one first. The motion to approve?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any modifications or amendments? If not, all in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So voted. And the other date was for the regular meeting?
October 22nd.
As of 22nd? Which also looked like a motion to approve those minutes?
I'm great with my motion to approve it.
Second?
Second.
Any amendments or modifications to those? If not, all in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So voted. Hi, Anita. Just approved minutes. First item is a request for determination of applicability to determine deck replacement for subject to the Wetlands Protection Act or Northampton City Wetlands Ordinance. This at College Lane at the Smith Conference Center. Someone here representing Smith?
Sir.
Hello.
My name is Scott Kiter. I'm with Kiter Builders, and we are acting as a construction manager for Smith College on that project. Would you like me to fill you in?
Yeah, can you summarize? We've seen the material that Sarah sent.
Sure.
Including where exactly it is in the building.
Okay, sure. This is on the back side of the building on the pond side. It is an existing deck which is structurally failing. And we did a recent renovation in that building. The college is really looking to turn that building more into a, they're doing more weddings and things of that nature. So the deck is under a lot of use and has a lot of occupants out there. And so we're looking to replace the deck in its exact location. And for that matter, we are, the structural engineer who is involved in the project has approved you reusing the existing concrete piers.
Mm-hmm.
Those piers are very large, but they're actually from hydrostatic pressure and time are tilting downhill. And so part of the scope of our project is to hand excavate behind them and actually right them. So in terms of, and of course we worked with you guys in Berkshire Design and so on and so forth with the other project. In terms of the wetlands and where I think that there's no heavy equipment that we can get back into this location, unfortunately. So any and everything we're talking about doing here is manpower and shovels.
Wow.
And so there's very little subsurface work outside of those piers. There is one additional sonotube that we will be putting in, and we will be removing, I believe, one in a separate location. Again, hand digging it. And you'll notice in the project, beneath the deck, I'm sorry, to answer your question, the deck is located right behind the annex between the old building and the old wood frame building and the newer masonry building.
Is that the smaller portion on this diagram?
So it's the area that's not shaded on this older plan. So it's sort of in between the house looking.
It's between the two, that's correct. It's that, and that is the actual deck.
Okay.
The, beneath the deck is connected to a frost wall, which above the frost wall is an old bluestone patio, and part of this, which is existing, and part of this project is to make this deck ADA compliant. And so we'll be overlaying that patio with sleepers and basically bringing that deck elevation up just a little bit so that it comes to the thresholds of doors that we installed last year. And really, that side of the deck is connected to that frost wall. The other side is supported by those three piers. Beneath that, that's approximately 12 to 14 feet in distance. Beneath that is a pretty steep gradient. And I think that's part of the problem as to why those piers are just tilted down. And so what I had proposed to the college was maybe just breaking that grade a little bit with even just a 2-foot little retaining wall that has no other purpose than just lessening that pitch just a little bit. And we would reuse the same material that's there, more or less etch that slope just a little bit to set, you know, a versa block type of wall into place, and then you know, appropriately allow, put drainage and crushed dome on the back side of the wall and let water flow through. Mm-hmm. And above that, we would use a combination of basically filter fabric and maybe some angular stone just to kind of stabilize the earth. And I'm just talking about beneath the deck. Downhill from the deck is an approximate 5 to 6 foot flat kind of walkway. And I did bring some photos for you guys here.
Under the deck now, is it gravel?
It's just dirt, yeah, just gravel, dirt, nothing in particular. Sorry. It's nothing other than the dirt that the guys pushed out of the way. And so what we were planning to do is basically downhill from just on the downhill side of that flat spot was to use stakes and straw waffle and you know, go way beyond the work location and come up. And that's really all I was going to do unless you guys had any other.
That was going to be your erosion control thing?
Erosion control in case we were to receive a heavy rain while some of the work was being done.
When was this planned?
We're really trying to get this in now because
before
the winter. And really, you know, the deck demolition is a few days. It's really just, you know, four guys getting in there and cranking these back. And in terms of that wall, if the college wants to do that and you guys approve it, then we would probably do that in the spring. I don't know that we would be able to get all that done before Mother Nature.
That was my question. What, that's separate from, it's just a retaining wall to help so that the slope doesn't make all the stuff come down.
Exactly.
Can you tell me more about that? That doesn't have to be done during the construction itself. It's not structural.
No. As a matter of fact, one thing I left out, when we write these piers are 2 feet in diameter, 5 feet deep, and they sit on a 2 foot by 2 foot by 6 inch footing.
Wow.
They're very big. So when we bring those guys back, we're gonna be using that frost wall. And we're gonna actually put, with a healthy epoxy system, we're doing eyelets, hoops there. We're gonna actually be using tension rods that we're gonna connect to those piers so that it will hedge against the top of that pier coming back down again per the structural engineer. But what I'm just proposing...
Going into the frost wall under the...
Under the other side of the deck. Yeah, there's a 10-inch concrete wall there. So basically, just going to be putting, you know, right now, that you can see in these photos, possibly, that they actually have cables under there to try and keep the things from falling. But we're going to use a little bit of a better system, but it's the same concept. But the only reason I was thinking, or the location of that wall I'm proposing would be just downhill of the piers. One of the other reasons for it is that slope is steep enough that at the bottom edge of the pier, it's actually, there's not even frost depth there. So it would put the wall just beyond the piers. It would allow us to get that material up a little bit higher. You can kind of see that in the photos.
Are you able to tell, is it just the piers that are tilted, or is the footing actually...
It's the whole thing. They're...
So you've got to go all the way?
We're going all the way down, and then we're going to, once we've got everything where we want, we're going to pour a flowable fill underneath the footing to occupy any of that void that we create.
You're going to have to use a hand winch or something to pull those babies.
We're talking, yeah, exactly. Probably a power...
Four guys leaning against it.
Oh, no. It's going to be cables and, yeah, some Egyptian technology, I think. But if you see, you can probably see in a few of those photos, they've got temporary bracing in place. I mean, it's actually a dangerous situation. They should not be having any occupants on that deck at this point. So they're definitely forced into this situation. The structure of the pier in the middle is actually rotted away and completely failed. And I believe the deck is over 30 years old.
So the retaining wall is not on the plan itself? The way that you can go, or is it? I missed it.
It is not, and Sarah and I talked about that this morning. I can submit something to you guys, but I didn't, based on our conversation today, I didn't do it just so that... Just because honestly, I haven't really...
It sounds like the college hasn't decided either.
Yeah, Gary Hardwell is the project manager, and he's got a lot on his plate right now, so there's a lot of elements to this project that are still kind of unwinding as we move forward, including the cable rail system and other pieces. But what we're trying to push to do here is get approval to get in the ground before we get shut down.
Right.
My thought was just that 2-foot retaining wall, 18-inch to 2-foot retaining wall, would be literally 1 foot in front of and 1 foot wider than the three piers. So I could literally draw it on the plan, what I'm talking about doing.
1 foot?
1 foot downhill.
Downhill. And so it extends 1 foot beyond the width of the...
Exactly. Pier. Just so that we've got some material behind it and the front of the pier, just again for some frost protection. And
how deep? You have to go, what, 4 feet deep with the wall below the grade?
I don't think so. I would go with what VersaBlock requires us to do.
Okay.
The block that we're talking about is that block that gets filled with crushed stone.
Yep.
And I think it relies on some spikes and some other things, but I don't think we don't have to go. It's not a structural wall in terms of bearing.
Okay.
So I thought, you know, what we're talking about potentially doing is a dead man at the just beneath the upper block and kind of putting some fabric up under that dirt. It's a non-critical wall, in my opinion, because the structural engineer has actually authorized this whole project without it even being there. I just think it's a good idea, that's all.
So I guess the question before us is, would we require that to have a separate plan before proceeding? But it sounds like that's not going to happen this season.
I don't believe that we're going to make it.
So that's pretty close to the resource area, close to the shore.
I think we
not much room there.
And we probably at least want to.
It's still under the deck, though, isn't it?
It's under the footprint of the deck. The deck cantilever is 3 feet out, so this wall is actually under the footprint of the existing deck.
Yeah, no, my guess is we wouldn't have a problem approving it, but I'm just always a little wary about saying, oh, yeah, go ahead.
What you're approving?
Well, yeah, it can always be a condition prior to construction.
Right, prior to construction.
Yeah, I mean, I think at this point, what I really am after is approval to proceed with writing the piers and pouring our new sonotube as drawn, and just understanding what you guys would want for erosion protection.
Any other questions from the commission? Sarah, your comments?
Since it's on the same footprint, it didn't seem to me like it would constitute an alteration.
So, motion closed?
No.
Oh, any public? Thanks for the reminder. Any comments or questions from public? Not a motion to close.
Motion closed.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
So we have staff recommendation, issue a negative determination that the area is subject to the Wetlands Act, but will not alter an area because it's already altered and degraded. There was one in your language there, there's one thing that seemed contradictory to me, Bill, I said that this, due to the distance of the resource area and location work, standard conditions should not be required. And then it says include standard.
It should say.
That
should,
I thought that
no, should be.
Should be.
Should be.
Yes. I agree. So if somebody want to move?
Well, add one about the drawing.
Pardon me?
Add one about the drawing.
And we want to add conditions, right, about need to see the plan for the retaining wall before construction on that part of the project.
Okay.
Is that just a checkoff or from?
I would think so.
I mean, I think that if it's within the footprint, the problem. It sounds like it would be. So
yes.
You can add that as a note, but make sure that it's on the plan before it happens. As long as that retains.
So that would be part of the order of conditions? Just
right.
One of the standard, yeah, one of the additional conditions.
And when I do that, Sarah, I'll submit the type of block and the wall system we'd be using.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Any other amendments, conditions?
You mentioned, I can't remember, he mentioned the erosion control verbally, but I don't remember his name itself.
The state fails?
Yeah. The type sounded fine just because there's not really any disturbance of any kind going on, but I just didn't know where it was.
Yeah, okay.
There's the logs.
Yeah. That should be in the standard conditions, right?
Yeah, but the erosion control is part of the standard conditions.
Is that sufficient?
We can figure that out.
Okay, so I can talk with you and maybe you can meet me down there or something. Okay.
All right, I propose staff recommendations with the additional condition that the retaining wall to be done that is within the footprint and to check the submit a plan. Check the
plan submitted to Sarah for staff approval.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So voted.
Thank you very much.
Next item is the request for determination of applicability determine if the relocation of the underground drainage pipe is subject to the Wetlands Act or the Wetlands Ordinance. And this is a City of Northampton submission on Pleasant Street.
So this is sort of a joint city and potential developer application, because it's likely that anything that gets done on this lumberyard site will require that the brook be moved. So we just wanted to figure out exactly what we need to do that.
And this is just for the pipe?
Just the pipe, yes. And, and Joanne is here from Valley CDC.
Doesn't include the building?
It doesn't include the building, just the pipe.
And that would be done before anything happens? I mean, this is separate project that would happen
most
under this,
likely
under the direction of the city, so it's a city project.
It's a city resource, so the city put it in the pipe and needs access to it and would have sort of jurisdiction over what would go over it, but it's kind of a strange animal.
We don't get involved with the demolition of the existing building?
No. So Joanne, did you want to talk?
I'm Joanne Campbell, Valley CDC. When we have a option to purchase the lumberyard property, and we have site plan approval and CBAC approval. And early on, we had talked to the city about whether we could relocate the stormwater conduit because it runs diagonally through the property. And we certainly didn't want to build on top of it, and the city certainly didn't want us to build on top of it for access. And so we have at least, early on, have rerouted it to run parallel to the railroad and then come out into the street and connect to the existing. So designs are not yet done, but this is what we're expected, and the city would have control over what is the design and the construction with coordination with Valley's architect and civil engineers as well, and the railroad.
Is it in the railroad right of way?
It is not.
It's not on the property.
So now it runs.
It runs underneath.
It runs sort of directly right down the
railroad. It runs down Holly Street, then goes under the railroad, and then diagonally through the lumberyard property.
Where that dotted line is, Kevin.
Where the dotted line is. Yeah. But then.
I have a little bit bigger
one.
How deep is this? The thing's like 6 feet in diameter, anyways. But.
Yeah, it's like 7 feet by 4 feet with a wood plank. Built 1847. I think it's about 15 feet deep, if I remember. Don't quote me on that.
From the surface down to the bottom?
I think to the bottom of it.
Mm. It's going to be quite an excavation to get this
rounded.
And then the conduit would be closed off, whatever proper way to do that is.
Oh yeah, okay.
So they got to move it over to here.
I just couldn't see it on a tiny little.
Thank you.
Notice, I saw Sarah's description was that it was 19th century, but it's the middle of the 19th century?
1847.
1847.
And I think the last time DPW was in it was like the 1980s.
So basically just taking it around.
Yeah, I really enjoyed reading the 1981.
Yeah, that was interesting.
Because I part on part of my
the pictures weren't great,
that.
But interesting.
Right, well, the trouble is the report's what, 34 years old, so I have no idea what the condition of it is now.
Exactly.
Unless they did something recently. I want to walk through there.
Has anybody run a remote camera up through to see what shape it's in?
Way early to do that, but no. My understanding is the last time DPW was in the 1980s that anyone was in there. So I guess the water's flowing fine through there.
I wouldn't want to go in there.
Guys with the blowing tools.
So is there any endangered species in the
that evolved inside there?
There might be a few tents. That's under
you. Maybe it's the inspiration for the miniature.
Yeah.
That's right.
So are there questions from commissioners?
Reservations that it was a determination of applicability because of the amount of work that's going to be taking place, but then again, the whole site is built out.
Right, well, it's
completely disturbed.
There's no part of it, so it seemed like it didn't have buildings and sidewalks and paving and
So, is there some provisions that prevent excavation material getting into the downstream portion of pipe and causing a problem?
Well, I guess that's a sequencing issue. Would the new conduit be built first and then a gate opened in some way?
I'm not a civil engineer, but my understanding is that the pipe would be built, the new pipe, right, would be built, so the stormwater would still be running, and then at some point there's cut off and a connection.
Right.
The timing of that, I mean, like how long? I don't know. I'm assuming, again, the city is DPW, wants control of overseeing that, so the design piece would obviously include a piece so that there would not be, stoppage of it or however that works, but we don't have those design pieces yet.
Right. Okay. Probably address that like we did. Apparently they haven't even finished the design on it.
And sir, you can't really comment?
I accept to say that there are wetlands upstream, so that would make it jurisdictional. So this request is asking primarily whether the work would create any alteration.
Well, that's not enough. What are the resource areas that we're really considering?
There aren't any riverfront areas associated with this because it's piped for 7,000 feet, which is clearly longer than the ocean.
Yeah.
Technically, the inside of a pipe is bay.
Right.
In a technical sense. Clearly, it doesn't have any habitat value at this point. But
yeah, that was my challenge, is that there's nothing to go on, and I'm really not sure what we're deciding on. Because once you change the brook into a pipe, are we concerned with the downstream impacts on when it comes when it daylights? That, because if so, then I would want to see, at least a description of how they're going to, while they're doing the pipe reflow, are they just going to create the new pipe and then divert it when it's done? But like, what happens in the intervening time?
Well, I think that was Mason's question.
Yeah.
Is there going to be any?
I had no doubt they would build the pipe first. But then we'd do the connections. I don't think they can do it in a day. It's a huge pipe. So they're going to have to connect it at two ends and get the full. I don't know how they're going to do that, to be honest with you. I would think they would probably next do the downstream connection.
So that
then
it's got
go to the upstream.
To go.
So
yeah.
It starts flowing, but how they're going to do that. Maybe temporarily set up while we're building or while they're adding the pipe in there. I don't know. I don't know how we're going
to
do that.
Initial plans were to have it connect to the existing pipe under Holyoke Street. So it would just be diverting it through this site and having it go into a new route on the eastern side instead of through the site.
The actual transfer is what I'm having a problem.
You're wondering whether the mechanics of opening the upstream connection once it's built will actually result in sediment or release of some kind of materials that wouldn't otherwise be there.
Yeah, we don't even know what's down there, right? That way, I generally don't have a big problem with it. It's just there's nothing to go by. And I just feel uncomfortable saying, okay, city of Northampton, do what you want here, it's not going to have an impact. I don't think it will, but I just have nothing to go on, so I don't know how to.
Well, conceptually, we're sort of having a discussion that we should have a closed session for it.
Right.
Closing.
Yeah. I don't even know what the questions asked, though. That's why
thought about it when I read it is, okay, well, you talk about it as a pipe, even though it's a brick tunnel, really, and that the new pipe will just bypass a certain section that is right now totally disturbed, and so we don't have to worry about that area. And the construction is going to be merely bypassing that section, and so the except for the couple of hours, however many hours it takes to actually open the connection and whether there's any disturbance that results from that, this is, yeah, but afterwards with just a little different configuration to the pipe. So it's conceptually, it doesn't make any change.
Conceptually, we're guessing.
Right, but then I think that's Tim's question.
I would much rather have this continued and actually have a DPW personnel or an engineer or somebody tell us how this is going to be done. I think I would be more comfortable with that. I don't have a problem with the project. I just, like Tim said, there's too many questions.
More information about the
yeah, like, for example, how's it going to be sized? Is it going to be exactly the same size? Is it going to change the flow rate? Or it just, I mean, just having that documented that it's going to be this, it's going to have the same capacity as the existing pipe.
Well, the pipe it goes into is a 60-inch pipe. Again, I'm not an engineer, but I'm assuming it doesn't need to be bigger than that.
Right, but it's not even said that. It doesn't say anything.
Yeah, there's no design.
If they had put in any pipe that's smaller than that, then I would have a problem, but I don't have any.
And a construction description would have been great.
And just changing the way that it goes around, you know, the bend. It seems like there's a bend now where there isn't.
Well, it goes from a manhole.
So it's kind of, instead of going on a diagonal, it's going to go straight and then have to turn.
So there's all kinds of calculations that have to happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, yeah. Even if it's this, they say it's going to be the same size pipe, tell us how you're going to do this. No problem downstream as far as there's a wetlands downstream, right?
Well, there's a Mill River downstream.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, it comes out the outfall.
Sewer station.
So, in that case, probably good that we did not close the hearing, but we can continue the hearing requesting either or both more detail about the actual construction and the new pipe, and or someone here to discuss those issues so that we can document that we've actually ruled on something that we fully understand.
Next meeting date is December 15th. I guess this would be 5:30.
Sure. So we need a motion to continue this case until 5:30 on the 15th. Mm-hmm. Second.
Is that sufficient time to get?
I would say. I mean, I don't want to speak for the city, but mm-hmm. I know that the city and Valley don't have any design, and there's no expectation it'll be done by December 15th, so I don't know how you do something indefinitely until there's something more concrete. But that, I don't know what Sarah thinks.
That should be enough to speak to sizes. And
yeah.
If you can look
for a lot of it, it doesn't have a detailed plan, it's just more information about what the project is.
And it's not, this isn't going through a resource area or even a protected zone.
It's more of the downstream.
Right, it's right.
Impact protection.
And, you know, for all we know, that there's going to be some period of time when there could be some backup, and so there could be, it probably wouldn't go that far to hit a wetland all the way upstream. But anyway, without knowing the mechanics of how it's actually going to be working.
What happened during the flood, the 36 flood?
We wouldn't be connecting it during the rainstorm.
Oh, I think it was just all underwater.
It was just everything was underwater.
All right, so we're continued until the 15th at 5. All right.
Kevin, motion and second.
The motion and Jack, what's the second for that?
Second.
And now we are at 6 o'clock. Notice of intent for building addition and related work within riverfront area, number of these routes,
Good evening.
Good evening.
The Squire from Berkshire Design Group here on behalf of Ralph Blacksmith. I'll pass these around if it's easiest way to. Obviously, have plans in front of you. Their proposal is to add a 5,600 square foot building addition on the left side of the building if you're looking at it from Smith Street. Currently, that end of the site is entirely gravel. They use it primarily for stockpiling materials before they go into the shop to be fabricated. There's a partial steel structure, an open steel structure on that end of the building. You can see underneath where the heavy lines are for the building addition. There's some existing steel substructure there. But what they want to do is enclose that area, bring some of the operations that they currently do outside, inside. As part of this, in recognition of the riverfront area and back, which is Little Mill River, obviously this is, you know, well within the riverfront area, and in some places as close as, you know, 10 or 12 feet. So as part of this, we're proposing riverfront restoration, a lot of the gravel and some concrete area directly behind the building that we're proposing to remove and return to vegetation, scarify it, you know, loosen everything up, because I think that's, everything's been compacted over the years, so loosen the subgrade up, you know, bring in some good topsoil and restore that. Restore that area. There's at least a 1-to-1 ratio. There really are no other changes to the site that are proposed, other than just, again, taking some of their existing operations that are outside, moving them to the inside, quieting things down, and, you know, confining some of the work they do indoors. I know, talking with Sarah, that there were some previous orders of conditions, certificates of compliance that hadn't been, so we did submit for, I think we figured out how to, what happened and, you know, where everything, so hopefully that's all closed out now. And that this, you know, starts fresh with this permit again.
Okay. Is that the compliance?
Yeah, that's what we did in the last meeting.
Oh, okay.
My question was, back, you know, there was an enforcement order way back.
Right.
And the building, the addition was built actually without even building permits.
Right.
And now you're going to add another addition on, and you're doing just enough restoration to counteract the imprint of the addition. I don't understand why you couldn't extend the restoration to include all that part that's in the riverfront area that's still compacted gravel. That would kind of offset the original addition that was prepared without any permits.
My understanding, and going through some of those permits, is that I'm pretty sure that that enforcement order was for that steel substructure. That's where this is proposed now. I don't think they ever completed it. In talking with the owners from the blacksmith shop, you know, everybody's recollection was that that's what they started to build, that substructure, and then got stopped. The enforcement order was issued. You know, obviously didn't have the permits that they required, so they didn't go beyond that. Yes, this is. I mean, this addition encompasses part of that area. I think the issue with the loss of additional, you know, site area to restoration is that they currently use you know, the majority of their site for stockpile and laydown area when they get materials. And I know that they're, and just speaking with them in terms of how big, you know, they could potentially build financially or operationally, that there was a big discussion about how big they could build and not take away so much site area that it wouldn't render their business, you know, difficult to operate the way they operate now, because they do, you know, the trucks come in with raw materials, they offload it, bring it into the shop, fabricate it, bring it back out, depending on, you know, what things are, and then bring it to the job site. So a lot of that laydown and stockpile area, I think, is pretty critical to them. So I know there were a lot of discussions with them initially in terms of where we would locate some of this restoration area, because what's back there now, there's an area that's a concrete pad.
Yep.
Directly behind the building.
Yep.
There's three rectangles that are also shown on. Two of those are mechanical equipment. One is a, I believe it's a storage trailer that sits on the concrete.
But okay, it's storage. Against the building.
Yeah. And the point that they do, I mean, they need to be able to get vehicles back there to service and access some of that stuff, but they were fine giving up, you know, the area, you know, from there to the river. And this does also address some of the other requirements that may not have been addressed in that enforcement order. I know there was a removal of a pile in that corner. That's roughly directly north of where that building addition is. That's already been taken down. I think there were a couple of other things in that enforcement order about, removal of stuff in the riverfront or in the stream itself. I know that's all been taken out.
What do they do with the sand, the spent sand after they do the
sandblasting? That's one of the big reasons to build this addition, is they want to move all of the sandblasting operations inside.
Well, what do they? They must still have something to do. Where are they going to take the sand after it's been used for sandblasting?
Well, typically what they try to do is recirculate it, reuse it. I mean, they'll, you know, if they can contain it enough, usually they'll, you know, run it through a sieve again and reuse it, because it's not cheap material to purchase, so reusing it. So by moving all of that inside, it'll enable them to capture that a lot easier and control that much, much better.
And currently it ends up in the river.
Yeah,
I think a lot of it's pretty, real dusty. Pretty, it's
Where do they dispose of the waste material after they, you know, when they sandblast something, there's going to be rust particles and paint particles and everything else. What do they do with that?
I understand it gets broken down. I mean, from any sandblasting operation that I've seen, I mean, typically they'll try to recirculate. Typically, it's done in a booth, in a contained booth, and yeah, everything depending on what it is, but typically it'll be. They'll take all the sand, you know, from the bottom of the booth or wherever it is, and just put it back into the system, and it runs through a series of screens, so any of the, you know, debris or, you know, rust flecks or whatever that, you know, are caught in that screen. I've worked at, you know, one place that had a sandblasting operation that was very similar. So they don't have a big stockpile of stuff on site, I guess is
my question is, what do they do with that after it passes through all the sieves?
I imagine they throw it in the dumpster with all their other. I mean, I know, like I said, there aren't large piles of material, you know, disposed material on site.
Okay, so there's not a guy with a wheelbarrow heading over.
No.
It looks like sort of the leftover stuff from every operation. It's just accumulated, when it rains heavily, it doesn't end up in the resource area.
Because I imagine your concern was that sandblasting certain kinds of coatings, then you have hazardous materials that are actually getting ruined and getting pulverized. But if that should be a separate issue than the construction process.
It was a big concern. Sarah said that there was tons of sand down there all over the place.
Yeah, I think enclosing as part of the operations would probably be a good thing. I just wanted to make sure that everything that's out there gets cleaned up. It's kind of a mess.
Okay.
What kind of plantings are you intending?
So, well, I mean, what we've showed is a, you know, a New England conservation mix. It's a, something available from locally, wetland nurseries, but it's a, you know, variety of herbaceous and, you know, woody materials that, you know, it's spread like seed, but it's a different mix. It's something we used oftentimes for, you know, conservation areas or replication areas.
And so once there, that area is reseeded and restored, how will it be founded? And I can imagine that it could be encroached upon incrementally over time, both by accident and by design.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, good point. I don't know. I think we're certainly open to, you know, discussion in terms of how, you know, what satisfies your concerns. I completely recognize the concern. I pointed it out to them, you know, that, you know, we're gonna have to, this is gonna be off limits for you guys once it,
right,
once it goes away. So you're gonna have to make sure that, you know, you figure out A, your operations, but B, that everybody else knows to stay out of there. So if it's, you know, boulders, if it's something else, you know, I'm sure they've got plenty of steel that they could probably put up a, you know, a steel barrier somehow.
Well, when Downey was here, he always liked the boulders.
Yeah.
They also have forklifts. They can move the boulders.
They can move the boulders.
Right.
Do we know how, where there was some, and not only their parking area, but the surrounding parking areas. I wonder where the snow gets plowed to parking areas.
I don't know.
Well, they certainly have enough gravel surface to put it.
Right. All right, well, let's see.
I wouldn't think they would bother to shove it all the way around the back of the building.
Right. So just not sure of the topography.
See some total lines, yeah.
Wonder if the drainage goes toward the left.
Not a lot of topo here.
Does the gravel lot to the main area on the southwest is pretty flat, but the drainage area definitely goes towards the river.
When you want larger, yeah, this one shows it better if you want to.
Just hold it up and show us the drainage pattern.
Well, there's sort of a ridge right here.
Yeah.
So a lot of this goes that way. All of this comes back around and comes around there. But this, yeah, this is all relatively flat, and then it's steepest right along the bank.
Drainage diagrams, those pretty clear contour lines on there.
Not the drainage.
Right.
Oh, I see there at the bottom of the site plan.
Given the contours, I think you need erosion control. control up at the little restoration area. West of the addition.
West of the addition, oh, I got you. Yep, the smaller area?
Yeah, that small area, doesn't have anything behind it, and there's a slope eventually towards the, it'll take a while to get there. Other questions and comments from commissioners? Sarah, this is a, disturbance of 35 feet.
Well, it's split. So one of, it's a split zone property, so one is 35 and one is 10. But either way, since nothing's getting closer, except restoration, and that then complies with the ordinance.
I would imagine that 10 feet is probably the industrial.
Yeah.
Which is, yeah, would be the right side, I guess, of that. If the zoning line runs north to south, almost where probably one third of that addition.
Yeah, so since the only new alteration being proposed is the addition, that's well outside the no encroachment zone. Mm-hmm.
Wow. Part of that small restoration area, back to the west, is right at the edge of a very steep slope. So that definitely needs some kind of erosion control there.
Like this, that's not that slope.
Yeah, it's that vegetated slope and hedge that you can see in the, actually in the, there's some glass cave in that picture, or glass here. You can see it.
So it's actually, that's an upward slope.
Is it right?
Oh, is it?
Yeah, it goes up. Yeah.
It's kind of like a terrace.
Yeah, I think it buffers all the residential. If you look in the last page of that sort of handout that I gave you, there's a picture of it in the last page, sort of looking in that direction.
Oh, okay. Yep. You're right. Sorry.
No, that's fine.
Is that a constructed flood control? You know? I know it's not officially part of the city's flood control.
Yeah, no, I don't know what that is. Unless it was just created when they carved out this site. I don't know, you know, there's, yeah, I don't really know what that is, what the intention of that is.
Yeah, if you put the overall map on top of it.
Nice for the neighbors, though.
Yeah. Yeah, it's certainly an adequate buffer.
Sarah, your comments are that make sure that erosion control, that the prior to work, the detailed restoration plan.
If the commission agrees that something beyond what's shown is needed.
Well, your comments about that, the mechanics of gravel removal and paving and excavation, soil replacement, and planting plan. Makes sense to have all of that specified before work begins. And then you also recommend to make sure the sand that has already accumulated there goes someplace else besides downhill. So where do we need erosion control, since in the small restoration area, that's an upgrade.
So it's shown at the boundaries of the riverfront restoration area.
That's all the heavy dotted
line? Yeah, over the river. And then the new addition of the, at the smaller restoration area.
Yeah, basically it's from the bottom of the steep slope to the end of the northwesterly corner of that small area.
And then generally we would require restoration to be conducted prior to the work. I don't know how feasible that would be in this case.
Might be fine.
Would the distance between the restoration area and the building pose a problem?
Yeah.
On the north side, it might get a little tight, you know, but I think they could still do, you know, most of that.
Well, most of it's right up against the concrete path anyway.
Most of it's up, right.
So it shouldn't be.
Yeah, it would be the only area that I could see potentially getting tight is where it narrows down on the very north side of that building addition, but I don't. They could certainly do the bulk of it.
They still have about at least 10 feet.
There should be, yeah, there's enough for a vehicle to drive back there, so.
So it require at least that the scarification be done prior to the building being constructed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they can easily remove. They've got.
When do they plan to do this?
Well, I know they were originally talking about trying to break ground this year and get a foundation, but that's not going to happen now. So I think next spring probably.
So getting in there in early spring and scarifying it. And,
yeah.
Throwing down.
Get rid of all material and
Sure.
So is there some usual recommendation for protecting the area that's just been restored?
We have
areas.
Downey always liked to see boulders that would not be possible for somebody with a riding mower to fit between or push over. Because then you start seeing people encroach on this. You've got, as I understand it, the cement pad in back is going to be an active work area.
It's not necessarily an active work area. They're not back there continuously. It's like a mechanical equipment in storage, but it's not one of their
busier. So there's got to be something at the edge of that concrete pad that says you can't go here.
Sure.
Because otherwise, one can imagine that. And suddenly there starts to be big hunks of iron, 3 feet, 4 feet.
So one guy that doesn't know, right.
Keep off the conservation links signs or something.
A polite sign.
For all the steel workers. Yeah, I'm open to options. I can ask them if they'd be, you know, if there's some sort of steel fence that they would want to make.
Right, because I think that given what they do for a living, they could probably sink some iron into the ground right at the edge of the...
Put a little guardrail kind of thing, yeah.
And this is raised, right?
Yes. Yep.
So maybe along some sort of fence guardrail along the edge of that?
Mm-hmm. Extend it all the way over, yeah.
And then this is going to be that in between the restored area and the new construction, that's going to be vehicle access?
That would be for occasional vehicle access, yeah, mostly for the mechanical equipment.
So there's got to be some defining boundary.
Along that edge, yep.
Definitely one of the conditions is going to be not to disturb that area.
Yep.
Right. After it's restored.
Yeah, I'm sure they could be bollards or some, yeah.
Okay. So, any other comments, questions before we close? Motion to close?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
All in favor, aye.
Aye.
So, looks like this is permittable. And just going to be a little... Well, let me not jump straight there. It looks permittable, but it's sort of a, there's barely enough restoration to make it permittable, but it is permittable. It's,
yeah, it's pretty skinny on the restoration.
But that probably is not a reason to try and say no, when in fact it seems that there is enough to pass muster. Just got to be pretty sticky about making sure it stays that way.
Yeah. Well, there are some benefits to doing the work they're doing that
right.
Enclosing the sandblasting is a good thing for the environment.
Yep.
And so it's an improvement in a bad, you know,
that's
bad
not
situation.
Something that's addressed in the law, but mm-hmm. The law can't address all possible conditions. So we have an order of conditions that would be standard conditions plus sorry, in your comments, verbal assurance that sandblasting is, and the whole purpose of this seems like they're going to move the sandblasting.
Yeah, I thought it was important just to have the discussion and make sure that the sandblasting wasn't going to get moved over to the other gravel area, but that doesn't sound like that's the case.
Okay. So the standard conditions plus going from the bottom that. Applicant should demonstrate that at least 75% of the surface of each restoration has been reestablished. Normally, we require three growing seasons.
Yep.
So that'd be one additional condition. Another that all the community's sand that's already there be removed from site. Third, that the details of the plan and be submitted to Sarah about the work to be done. Do you still, after this discussion, feel that that's needed to, or is it, I think given
how
close
think
to the bone this is to pass muster, we probably do want to see the actual plan.
Yeah,
you,
at least as part of the required sequencing plan. So I'll make sure, because we do require a sequencing plan too.
At what plan?
Sequencing.
Sequencing.
So I can, we, as long as it gets submitted at some point, in some manner, it's okay. And then we're obligated to make sure that this restoration area doesn't get disturbed in the future.
And that would include the steel fence, or if they want to propose something else, we'll entertain that, but.
And we could show that on the same set of plans?
Right.
Yeah.
And that we go, it needs to also protect that small restoration area. So, that, do you want to make that as a motion? Or would you, I assume we would have captured all of that. So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion, amendments, additions? All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you.
Glad to see that coming for.
Yes.
Doing it right this time.
Doing it right this time, that's.
Yes.
That's a big improvement.
I think, yes. I think getting all the ones there up to speed is the thing.
And you're on the planning board now, right?
I'm in the planning board now.
Perfect, good timing.
Just came from ZBA.
Our timing's so good.
Yep. Trifecta.
Just lucky you.
Nice to get them all done in one night, though. Actually, can I steal back some of those handouts?
Oh, sure.
And I can maybe recycle them at the planning board meeting, too. If you need one for your records, that's fine, but I didn't print out a whole bunch of copies, so.
They just get the tattoos, they're ugly guys.
Is the same guy?
What?
The same guy?
No. Oh, that's with the end of the teeth.
So, DEP said they wouldn't issue you an.
Wait, that changes everything.
Wow.
Really?
So that's, he owns that as an individual, and this is not owned by him as an individual.
Owns what?
We had an.
Oh, the end of the act.
Yeah. But DEP indicated they will not issue a final number for any work ever proposed on that site. Good compromise.
Yeah.
Look like fun, try to work in that.
No, it's awful. It's better than the crutches, but yeah, I hate this thing. I hate it. Could be worse.
That's true.
All right, we now are looking at Sarah's proposed amendments.
Tattoos are ugly site on Route 10.
Yeah.
Right?
So that's Ralph.
What?
That's Ralph.
That's Ralph. Oh.
Am I missing them yet?
Yeah. Wow. Remember the enforcement that we did that was never addressed for the cutting on Route 10?
Oh, oh yeah.
The guy
that was Ralph.
This is Ralph. So this is Ralph's blacksmith. That's
got
Ralph.
Pretty angry there.
Yeah. But it's not exactly the same ownership, so we couldn't make that enforcement carry over to this part.
What I don't totally get, because I don't understand all the rules here, I just pretend like whatever. So if we knew all this sand was sort of ending up into the.
We didn't.
Oh, we didn't.
No,
until
we
this.
Didn't know that until
Jack this.
And I went out there and said, oh, there's sand that kind of every place.
It's like a beach.
A really good situation. And it's the really fine sort of silica.
Mm.
So I just wanted to make sure they vacuumed it all up and dealt with it before it all ends up in the old Mill River bin. And the previous enforcement was issued for. No one was really exactly sure what part of the building it was, but it was sort of this half conversion of the gravel area, we think, into this new area.
That was a while ago.
Oh, yeah.
2002?
2002.
And they didn't get any building or zoning permits either.
Oh.
It's all my Wild West.
Oh, it's a shady area for a crew.
So, Sarah, you have some proposed
yes.
amendments to the wetlands.
Okay, so just go page by page, really?
Sure.
Do it. So page two, we've suggested deleting this water supply protection overlay reference because that zone doesn't exist anymore. So that seems
really?
To make sense. No, so it's not now it's the water supply zone, and there's a floodplain overlay. So we've just, the intent and the distance is the same, we've just corrected the reference. So in the one below, we've added water supply zone and floodplain overlay, and that's still 200 feet within the vernal pool. And those areas that they reference are the same. So it just, it went from being an overlay district to an actual zoning district.
Okay, so, but there's no change of substance?
No, there's no substance change, it's just the reference to zoning is correct now. So that water supply zone is the former water supply protection overlay district. And the floodplain overlay we never had before, that's new. Page six?
Yeah. The comments about the vernal pool, that's new, right?
Comments,
Vernal pool areas within 200 feet?
No.
No.
No, that's all existing.
It's redundant with the next. Vernal pool resource area size description, right? You just deleted that whole reference.
Yeah, so it was specifically referencing this water supply protection overlay district. And it just doesn't exist anymore, so there's no sense in referencing it. But so now that is the water supply zone. And then we've also added the floodplain overlay too. So that hasn't extended the vernal pool resource area size. And then page six, I've run into this a few times. So I've suggested adding the language from the regulation for the Wetlands Protection Act to read that the application of permit required by this chapter shall not apply to those activities necessary for planning and design purposes that are temporary in nature and have negligible impact. These may include but are not limited to installation of monitoring wells, exploratory boring, sediment sampling, surveying, septic system, percolation tests, and wetlands delineations. Because we don't have this listed as an exemption, technically all of those things would currently require a wetlands permit, which really just doesn't make a whole lot of sense. The activities that they may result in will later need permits. If you want to put in a septic system, then you need to do a permit. If you're filing an NOI for something based on a wetlands delineation, then you would need to file a permit. But these things just never, in my experience, have risen to the level.
Yeah, that one would stay there forever.
Yep, makes sense.
Page seven, the first change is just a correction. We're no longer the Office of Planning and Development, which is Office of Planning and Sustainability. And then the next suggested change is in reference to a change in the state regulations for a water notification. So now for very large projects, you are only obligated to notify those abutters within 50 feet of the actual place where you're doing the work. So if you have a parcel that's larger than 50 acres, you just go from that area rather than...
When did that change?
End of last year.
Wow.
So this actually came up because DPW is proposing some work at the lower Roberts Reservoir. And that parcel includes all of the reservoir complexes, so they're notifying, in effect, half the city, which doesn't make a whole lot of sense. So they're doing some very small sort of in-channel work, but because they have an extremely large parcel, I think 200, 300 acres, they're forced to let everyone know within 100 feet of the boundary of those 300 acres. So I just suggested referencing the Code of Massachusetts regulations. I think that's it.
Just a little bit down below again with the protection of the water shop, you changed the wording.
Oh yeah, so on page 14, it's the same.
11, there's something on the smaller one, 11.
Yeah, protection
of
water.
Yeah, so that's also deleting references to zoning that doesn't exist.
Yeah.
Not changing substance, just correcting the reference. And then page 14 is the same. So we're not allowing anyone to do anything they couldn't do before. We're just correcting the same reference. And then just one last change to change Office of Planning, Development, and Sustainability.
I hate to do this, can I just jump in for some wordsmithing?
Sure, that's what we do.
Feel like down now. Go back up to seven. There's this, oh no, that's not seven. It's the one with negligible impact. Six. A comment at the end of that first sentence bugging me. Can you change it to say the application permit required by this chapter shall not apply to those activities that have negligible impact first?
We could do that. I did not write this language though. This is from the CMR.
Really?
It is.
Because that comment shouldn't be there.
It shouldn't.
And then it's confusing. I think it's a little confusing.
Yeah, we certainly can change it. The intent is the same, but yeah. I just
this is exactly the language that's
take the comma out.
Well, not really, because then I don't want to. Yeah.
Well, it's
because there's too many ands in there.
Oh, I agree.
It's not really poorly worded, and I think the focus should be on that they have negligible impact.
And we could just
and they also have to be necessary for planning. I mean, that's they're both necessary attributes of exempt activities.
Didn't have to
diagram. So they have to be negligible, and they also have to be involved in planning.
To those activities that have negligible?
That have negligible impacts and are necessary. Yeah.
Because you could have some planning activities that would have a lot of impact.
Right.
Diagram their sentences.
All right, so the application permit required by this chapter shall not apply to those activities that have negligible impact and are
necessary for planning and design purposes that are temporary in nature.
That's not right.
You can't just can of worms. That's how I would alter it as a first pass to be easy.
We could change the that to another and. Planning and design purposes and are temporary. And have negligible impact. So they have to be all of those things.
Oh, yeah. No, to have those three qualities.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. They put it at another comma. That aren't necessary. Planning and design purposes, comma, that are temporary in nature, comma, and have negligible impact. Or and that have negligible impact. So you have those meet those three characteristics.
Yep.
I like that better.
Yeah.
Okay.
Must be a metric better.
Well, Brad, bring up the ghost of Demi.
I think he would have
found that one.
The language in the CMR is really bad.
Most high school kids don't come right away.
Well, do we need to vote on this to pass it along to council?
Yes.
All of those changes make sense to me, especially when they're so elegantly worded. Motion to recommend to the city council that we adopt these amendments to the city's wetlands ordinance.
Yes, so moved.
And a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And holiday schedule, Sarah?
So, 2 weeks from today is Thanksgiving. Please don't come here.
Nope.
And then we will meet again on December 15th. And we will discuss this very large dam removal application, get some follow up about this pipe under most of downtown.
Yep.
And maybe Hinckley Street.
Maybe what?
Maybe Hinckley Street.
Wow.
Oh, and then maybe also that project that I mentioned, the DPW had to do a very large abutter notification. So by New Santee Beach, there's a lot of erosion that started, I think, Hurricane Irene or maybe even before. So they put together a plan to address that. It's a busy night.
Wow.
Okay.
town meeting.
At 5:30.
At 5:30.
So that could be a 2-3 hour night.
It could be. We haven't had one on a lot of.
Well, then that won't happen until January, the next one.
Yeah, and the next meeting after that will be January 14th.
I can make a brief report on the CPC. It looks like all the conservation recommendations are lining up to be passed, but it's not a final vote yet on that, but they all have favorable reviews by the group, so I expect them to be.
Good to hear.
Carried.
So we get, so that's December, we'll just say 15th, 14th?
15th.
Which is a Tuesday.
Tuesday. And then we have January 14th.
Yeah, then we're back to our normal second fourth.
I'm going to be gone in February, so don't do anything important when I get back.
Well, hoping that we'll have
fun. Pretty much.
Oh, good. Someplace warm and sunny?
Hawaii.
Yeah, I'll do
it. Tough to take.
And are you doing the Costa Rica trip?
I am. I was just going to say that I'm maybe at 14th, if I change the dates around. 14th.
And Sarah, are you going to Belize?
Yes, that's why we're meeting with you.
Wow. Oh, nice. I didn't realize that was
there. I'll be having some wonderful therapy.
Good for Mason Pharma, so we're back on. And we are still down 2 people and no one has applied, so if anyone knows anyone who's interested in being on the concert.
I've nudged a couple of people, we'll see if I can get
a woman who was here.
I think she was here for the Market Street Brook.
Okay, she is. Looks very familiar. I believe she was the chairman of the Huntington Conservation Commission for a while. Long time ago, because I don't know, I had to go before the Huntington Commission. The town was sensitive to wind.
So I have no
nice windstorm in there one time.
No permits, no mail?
Wow.
Okay.
Nobody likes us, huh? We'll
do it.
All
so
in favor?
Here we go.